What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous videos of this series, we learned and defined a few concepts that will help us be more flexible and allow us to easily come up with better solutions during a system design interview. Today, we are going to tackle one possible question you may encounter during such interviews, and we're going to drill down the approach and thought process leading to one possible outcome. So, we are going to kick off this series with the tiny URL problem, which asks us to design a tiny URL-like service. You see, tiny URL is a URL shortening service that produces short aliases for long URLs, commonly referred to as short links. Upon clicking these short links, you are redirected to the original URLs. To simply illustrate this, suppose we have this very long link. Our service will take in this URL and will produce a unique short URL that maps to this and only to this link. When we make use of the short link, we are redirected to the original one. Now, if you have a code-first mentality, and if you're used to solving lead code-like problems, you might attempt to represent this illustration in code. And to do that, we'll first create a class that provides the ability to shorten or encode a given URL, and the ability to decode or retrieve the original URL given the shortened version. To store and allow fast lookup of the URLs, we are going to make use of maps, of course. The key will be the shortened version of the URL. Why? Well, because if we do that, retrieving the original version or decoding a shortened URL becomes a simple GET request. On the other hand, to encode a given URL, we will first need to generate a corresponding code for it while making sure that this code was never used before, i.e. it is unique for that URL. Then, after storing that URL alongside the original given one, in the map we created, we can return it to the user. To generate a code of length 7, for example, we can make use of all alphanumeric characters, then randomly select 7 of these characters and append them at the end of a given prefix, which is usually your server's domain. Of course, this is not the optimal way to do it, but for now it will do. Okay, this solution looks kind of complete, but one last thing is still missing. You see, what if the provided long URL was already shortened and is already stored inside the map? We don't want to shorten it again, right? We want to return the shortened version directly to the user. To do that, we will have to add an additional check on the long URLs stored to make sure the provided one doesn't exist. However, doing that will tremendously increase the complexity of the encode or shorten method because traversing the values of the map is not done in constant time like it is with the keys. To fix that, we can trade time for space and create an additional map with its keys inversed and update it simultaneously with the first map. This new map will have the long version of the URLs stored as keys and will allow us to look up these URLs in constant time before every shorten or encode operation. Okay, this Java solution looks great, but that is not exactly what the interviewer is looking for in this kind of interview. You see, this solution will help us transition to the second part, so it is not entirely wrong to go through it. However, we must point out that this is not a full-fledged solution, that it is not going to work for large-scale applications. You see, this hash map is in memory, and as soon as we exit from our application, everything will be lost. What we need is a server, exposed APIs, and a database. We also must fix this implementation to align with the functional and non-functional requirements, also known as FRs and NFRs given by the interviewer, and if none are given, we should ask them about these requirements. Then, based on these requirements, we should do a brief resource estimation. We don't have to go through every single detail, we just need to provide enough information to relay to the interviewer that we have an idea about where we're heading. And finally, after that, we must lay out the complete design. When we reach this step, implementation becomes non-necessary and most probably not feasible given the limited time we have. Okay, let's go ahead and start by laying down the requirements of our application. Now, let's suppose that the functional requirements are as follows. Our service should be able to generate a unique shorter alias of a given URL. It should be able to redirect the user to the original URL when provided with a short link given the appropriate rights. It should allow a user to delete a generated short link given the appropriate rights. It should allow us to serve at least 1500 billion URLs. And finally, each generated link should have a default set expiration time of 6 months, but users should be able to set the expiration time based on their requirements. As for the NFRs, let's go with availability. Our system should be highly available because even a fraction of the second downtime would result in URL redirection failures. Scalability, our system should be horizontally scalable with increasing demand. Readability, the short links generated by our system should be easily readable, distinguishable, and typable. Latency, the system should perform at low latency to provide the user with a smooth experience. and unpredictability from a security standpoint, the short links generated by our system should be highly unpredictable. This eliminates the possibility of someone guessing the short URLs our system produces. Okay, let's start with a couple estimations and suppose that we will be making use of the 62 alphanumeric characters we previously used to generate our code or shortened link. This means that we will be able to produce 62 power n links at one time, n being the length of the link. If we choose to make n equal 7, similarly to what we did at the beginning of the video, then we will be able to roughly serve 3500 billion links, which is more than enough to meet the given functional requirements, so let's go with that. Other estimations can involve storage, bandwidth, and memory. You see, since the default storage time is set to be 6 months, and we can estimate that we'll be roughly have 200 million requests per month, it means that at least 1200 million links will have to be stored over the same period. And if each shortened entry is estimated to take, let's say, 1 kilobyte, then we will need 1.2 terabytes of storage at any point in time. Again, these estimations are based on given requirements. I came up with the 200 million and 1 kilobyte criteria just to give you an example, but during an interview, this will most probably be provided by the interviewer. If they aren't, then go ahead and ask about this information. They are waiting for you to ask about it, or at least to validate the estimation you had in mind with them. Okay, after laying down the estimations that cover the requirements provided by the interviewer, we can go ahead and define our system APIs. First, we will need a shortening API that takes in the original URL to shorten alongside a user key or username, and optionally an expiration time. If the expiration time is not provided, we will set it to 6 months as previously mentioned. The second API we need to expose is the redirect one. This API will take in the shortened version of a URL alongside the user details and return to the user the original URL associated with it. The final API to create is the delete one, which takes the user key and the URL shortened version as input. If the shortened URL is not associated with that user, then a not authorized response should be returned. That's it. Let's tackle the actual design now. As you might have guessed, the main component of this design is the database. We previously covered, and on several occasions, databases, so feel free to check the links in the card above. You see, for services like URL shortening, there isn't a lot of data to store. However, the storage must be horizontally scalable. The type of data we need to store includes the user key or user details, and the mappings of the URLs, that is, the long URLs that are mapped onto short URLs. Our service doesn't require full user registration for the generation of a short URL, so we can skip adding certain data to our database. Additionally, the stored records will have no relationships among themselves other than linking the URL creating user's details. So, making use of a relational databases won't be much use in this context. Considering everything we just mentioned, and the fact that our system will be read-heavy, NoSQL is a suitable choice for storing data. MongoDB in particular is an excellent choice for the following reasons. It uses the leader-follower protocol, making it possible to use replicas for heavy reading. It ensures atomicity in concurrent write operations and avoids collisions by returning duplicate key errors for record duplication issues. Okay, after combining all the blocks we discussed, that is what our design looks like. Now, besides these elements, we can also incorporate other building blocks like load balancers, caches, and rate limiters, allowing us to meet all our NFRs. Load balancing will improve availability. Since we have plenty of time before a short URL being generated and subsequently accessed, we can safely assume that our DB is geographically consistent and that distributing requests globally won't cause any issues. Caching might also prove essential since our problem is read-intensive. In this case, a horizontally scalable cache system with minimal data structure requirements will do. Additionally, since we are tying each URL with a specific user, then a rate limiter might also prove essential. Limiting each user's quota is preferable for adding a security layer to our system. We can achieve this by uniquely identifying users through their unique user key and limiting their quota. The final design diagram of the shortening system can be seen in front of you. Let's reanalyze the system together and see how these pieces provide the overall functionality. First, shortening. Each new request for short link computation gets forwarded to the application service. Upon successful generation of the short link, the system sends one copy back to the user and stores the record in the database for future use. Next, redirection. Application servers, upon receiving the redirection requests, check the storage units, i.e. caching system and database for the required record. If found, the application server redirects the user to the associated long URL. Finally, deletion. A user can delete a record with a request to the application server, which forwards the user details and the associated URL's information to the database server for deletion. A system-initiated deletion can also be triggered upon an expiry time. Again, we could further expand this design and add as many requirements and APIs as we want, but I'll leave it at that for this video, and we'll make sure to dive deeper into system design questions in the future uploads of this series. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.